And with a lot of products, we have a lot of APIs. And when we have a lot of APIs, we have a lot of monitoring metrics. And that's where our journey begins. We are going to run into some issues that I'm going to discuss some issues that we ran into while gathering these monitoring metrics concurrently. All right? So let's begin. So the first, the most important question, what's in it for you? Why should you attend this talk and what do you have to gain from it? So firstly, we are going to have a very interesting demoable debugging story that I'm going to walk you through, during the course of which we are going to see some surprising results in profiling as well as tracing the code. And during the while we are debugging these issues and root causing them, we'll take a selective peek under the hood of two very interesting Python networking libraries, grequests and gevent. And all of this is, all of the demo code and slides are online, so you can also try it out for yourself. And we will answer a very critical question. How many monkeys fit in a Clint Eastwood movie title? I know this sounds a little weird. Actually, little is an understatement, but this will all come together. Stay with me, this is going to be fun. All right. So what was the use case? What led to the issue that we are talking about? So we had a Python program which did thousands of HTTPS gets. It ran slow on Python 2.7, but it ran fast on Python 3.7. Now, as you know that the support for Python 2.7 is going to go away in Jan 2020, I did not even bother to debug the problem. The end. Thank you for your time. But that's not true. I did debug the problem. That's where all the learnings came from. And let us look at the use case again in a little more detail now, with the assumption that we are actually going to solve something. So we had a daily reporting tool which did thousands of HTTP gets. It ran on an AWS EC2 instance, and it just ran once per day. It just sent out some daily reports. And it took around 20 to 25 minutes to run. And it was using the request module in Python, which means it was handling one URL at a time. So we called one URL, got the data, called another one, got the data, and so on, which means the requests were being processed serially, right? And we had to do some migrations for this code, which means we had to migrate from AWS EC2 instances to AWS Lambda. Now, AWS Lambda is a functions as a service offering by AWS, which allows you to run your code without worrying about the underlying infrastructure, right? And we had to move from HTTP to HTTPS because the APIs were moving to HTTPS. And for obvious reasons, we also had to move from Python 2.7 to Python 3.7. And that is where the problem started. The problem that we faced was that AWS Lambda has a 15 minutes max runtime. What that means is that if you give your code to AWS Lambda to run, it will run it, but it has to complete within 15 minutes. Because if it doesn't, it will kill your code. And our existing code took 20 to 25 minutes to run, which means that we had to solve this problem. The most apparent solution at that stage was to convert serial gets into concurrent, because we are doing serial get requests one by one, and they can easily be made concurrent using Python, which means we had to move from using the request library to the grequest library. Now, grequest library, as the name suggests, is gevent plus request. And request module uses gevent to do some concurrency behind the scenes. What gevent is, what does it do in detail, we'll look at that later. But for now, you need to know is that when you use requests, you are using a blocking socket, which means if you are sending two requests to a server, the flow is you send the request, you block and wait for the server to respond, and then you receive the response. Similarly, you send the second request, you block and wait, and then you receive the response. So the requests are being sent and processed serially. But when you use grequest, you have the advantage of getting a non-blocking socket. What that means is that when you are sending the same two requests to the server, the flow is send the request, don't wait for the server to respond. Send another request, don't wait for the server to respond. And now, are there any more requests to send? No. All right, we'll block. But we'll block only for the duration up to which we get one of the responses, right? So one of the sends completes and we get a receive and we get another receive. Now this is an extremely oversimplified view of requests as well as grequests, but you can see that request is blocking twice and grequest is just blocking once. So grequest is doing something right. It's making our code run a little faster. Okay, so we will simulate the problem locally by having a local setup, which means we have an HTTP and HTTPS server running locally, and the URL that we'll be using for testing will be /delay/1, which means we'll be telling the server that please delay the response by 1 second so that we can inject some latency into the response and we can actually test the concurrency. And both the HTTP and HTTPS servers are powered by Go HTTP bin. Go HTTP bin is a Golang implementation of the httpbin.org site, and you can run that locally. It's a really cool project. You should check it out. But you know, now let's look at some code in action. We are at stage zero. We are at ground zero, right? We are using requests, and stuff is running slow. So let's try it out. So I have a HTTP and HTTPS server running here. All right. By the way, is the font visible to the folks at the back? All good? All right, cool. So on the left side of the, on the left panel, I'll be running Python 2.7 code, and on the right panel, I'll be running Python 3.7 code, all right? So we have request module, which we are using, and this is just a sample script, which is calling the HTTPS URL three times. So if we call, so as you can see the difference, there is Python 2, and then there is Python 3. So if we run the code for Python 2 and for Python 3, both of them run slow because the flow is send block receive, send block receive. So three URLs take 3 seconds. Similarly for Python 3, three URLs take 3 seconds. This is what was causing the slowness for us, and we wanted to fix this. All right. So Python 2.7 and 3.7 are slow. This is a known, this is a known issue. We want to fix this. So what do? We move from requests to using gRequests. So similarly, we have a test script which is using gRequests. We take it for Python 2. And then we take it for Python 3, right? And then we run them in parallel. Now, as you can see, Python 3 completed first. Python 2 is still going on. So Python 2 took for 5 URLs, it took 5 seconds. And Python 3 for 5 URLs, it just took 1 second. Now, let us make this a little more clear by telling Python 2 to call 5 URLs again. And in Python 3, we'll actually call 100 URLs. Right, and see what happens. So Python 2 is going on, and Python 3 completed. Right, so Python 3 completed faster than Python 2, even though it had a lot of more data to process. Right, now let us look at this from a server's perspective. This is the HTTPS server that we are running, and let us run it for Python 2 first. All right, so Python 2, first request, second, third, fourth, fifth. Right, so it's very clear that the server is receiving requests one by one, and it is processing them one by one. Let us do the same thing for Python 3. 100 requests. The server is inundated with requests, and it is taking them concurrently, and it is receiving and processing them concurrently. So we know that there is something going on which is making Python 2 slow. All right? But there is some improvement that Python 2 is doing if you notice carefully. So if we run the test request code again, this is test request, the one that was running slow for everyone. So this takes 3 seconds, but this line, notice this line, starting new HTTPS connection. So it is opening a connection, sending request, getting data, opening, sending, getting the data, right? But if we use gRequests for Python 2, even though it is running slow, you will see an interesting thing. The starting new HTTPS connection was done concurrently, but the request was sent serially. So it is doing something right, but whatever it is doing, it's not enough for us. It's still running slow, all right? So Python 2.7 is slow, Python 3.7 is fast. Now the question is, why is gRequests plus Python 2.7 plus HTTPS slow, even though Python 3.7 is fast? Because the code is the same. In both cases, if you see, we are running the same code, test gRequests, right? So slow for Python 2.7, fast for Python 3.7. So let us add some debug statements and quantify our assumptions. What we saw till now was that Python 2.7 was opening the connections concurrently, as you saw here. Opening the connections concurrently, but it was sending data serially. But Python 3.7 was a step ahead. It was opening concurrently and sending concurrently. It was doing the right things. So let us patch one of the logging modules with some data. So out here, the output that you are seeing, I optimized it so that it can be, it can fit into 80 characters. But if I were to enable, detailed logging, I would see a line like this in the code, which is actually, making the call. So let us patch that library with a simple debugging statement for Python 2.7. So this is where I've just bookmarked it. This is where the request is being made, connection.request. let us open this block so that we get a debugging statement. And similarly, let us do the same thing for Python 3. And this, all of this is running on my laptop. So it's a local setup that's causing us some issues. All right. So we have added the debugging statements. Now let us do the demo once again. Python 2 and Python 3. So Python 2 still runs slow, but look at this line sending requests, right? In case of Python 2, the sending request part happens and then the request is sent. Sending request, send request, sending request, send request. So sending request is just logging before the request is being sent. But in case of Python 3, requests are being sent concurrently. You see, sending request happens way before you get a response. So we know that Python 3 is doing it right, Python 2.7 is doing it wrong, right? So now let us solidify this problem completely by visualizing the flow. So in case of requests that you saw, Python 2 requests that you saw, what happens is send block receive, send block receive, right? So you have three URLs that you want to send to the same server. So how does the client work? It says get a URL, send block receive. Look at the value of T here. Get another URL, send block receive, send block receive. So the total time taken is 3.3 seconds because sending 0.05 seconds, processing 1 second and returning 0.05 seconds. So 0.05 plus 1 plus 0.05. So 1.1 seconds per request. 3 requests is 1.1 into 3, 3.3 seconds. So if you have n requests, it will be 1.1 into n, which is for 3 it's 3.30, for 10 it's 11 seconds. So this is slow. What we want is Python 3.7g request flow that we saw earlier. In that case, we are running fast, right? We are getting something like this. Python 3 g requests, right? So we were sending, not blocking. Send, don't block, send, don't block. Are there any more requests to send? No. Then block. How long should you block? You shouldn't block for 1 second, because by the time T2 and T3 were sent, P1 got some time to process the data, as in it got 0.05 plus 0.05, which is equal to 0.10 seconds to process the data. Now, because the requests were sent concurrently, they have hit the server, which means now if we block for 0.90 seconds for P1 to complete, both P2 and P3 also get 0.90 seconds to complete, which means that P2 and P3 get 0.90 seconds more to complete their work. And P1 gets completed, and in 0.05 seconds, P2 gets completed and P3 gets completed. So this takes less time, right? So if you look at the numbers, for n equal to 3, Python 3.7 takes 1.2 seconds, and for n equal to 10, it takes 1.55 seconds. So the growth of time in case of Python 3 is much less as compared to Python 2. This is what we wanted, but what we got was this. We were opening the connections in a concurrent way, but as soon as the connections were hitting the server, in case of Python 2, it went to its old way of send block receive, send block receive, send block receive, which means that Python 2.7g requests gave us zero speed gains over using the request module. We wanted this, but we got this. All right. So what's going on? So request is doing a send block receive, which we know, which we wanted to fix. Python 3.7g request is fixing the problem. It is giving us send, send, block once, and then receive, receive, which is fast. Python 2.7 comes along and says, okay, I'll also try to do the same thing, wherein, you know, I will open the connections concurrently, as you saw here. Open concurrently. So open, open. So we see, okay, it's doing the right thing, but then it reverts back to its old ways, send, block, receive. So we want to fix this. And we want to debug why Python 2.7 is running slow. So our observations till now are the same code is running with variable speed, and it depends on the runtime environment. There is no code chain that is causing this. It's the libraries present on the system that are causing this. So how do we fix this? We'll try to isolate the scenario using Docker and the local setup that we were running till now, because the HTTPS server that you saw that were running here were running on my laptop. Now let us move this out and move to Docker. we'll actually run the setup on Docker now, which means that we'll take stage one, which is the stage we are going to fix check now, and we'll take a minimal set of modules. These are the modules we'll install on the Docker container. We will not install anything else, so that our runtime environment is known to us, right? And we'll install gRequest module, which is the one that we need. And when you install gRequest, because gRequest uses gevent and request in the background, you could get gevent and request for free, and request uses urllib3, you would also get urllib3. But we want to be sure. So we are pinning the versions of the modules, right? And we are installing that data in one container. So once we have that data present in a container, we are actually having a Docker file present in stage one. And all we are doing is that we are installing those modules using pip install, right? So now you just have these modules present. There is no code being copied to the container because the same code is going to run on the container, which is lying outside the container. So if you look at the stages, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on, right? So similarly, we do it for stage one, Python 3.7, because we are comparing Python 2.7 and 3.7. And if we run a Docker compose, if you look at the PS output, you'll see something like this. Don't worry about the rest of the containers, but we are at stage one and we are running in Docker now. All right. So we are using a minimal set of modules, and each container represents a stage in our problem. And the containers are used in place of virtual environment. I could very well have used virtual environment to demo this also, but containers are easy to demo and you can try it out on your own without doing much work. All right. So this is the case that we have till now. Laptop, stuff running slow for Python 2.7 and code running fast for Python 3.7. What happens when we do a minimal Docker setup? So these are the modules that we'll install in the container, and this is the container that we'll run. All right. So let us do the same demo, request and gRequest again with HTTPS. Now, if you want to run a command inside a container, you have to do something like this: docker exec minus it, name of the container, and the command you want to run. So the test gRequest v1 is same as test gRequest. We just added some profiling and tracing code to it. So we want to run this command inside the container. And this is a little cumbersome to read. So what you could do is that you could take docker exec minus it and then write a shell script over it, and you could get something like this: /docker-exec and so on, right? But this is also, this takes up a lot of screen space. So we wanted to make it a little more user friendly. So what I've done is that I've taken this command and I've wrapped it in a shell script. So when I say stage equal to one, it patches this keyword. Py versions is 2.7, it patches 2.7 here. Protocol is HTTPS, so it takes this part. Count is 5, we are calling 5 URLs, and log level is debug. So this is easy to read. So we'll be using this, but internally it's doing docker exec, it's doing the same thing, right? So let us run for the container, let us run the same thing. gRequest with HTTPS. Python 2.7, Python 3.7. And remember, Python 2.7 was running slow on our laptop. So Python 2.7 copied, Python 3.7 copied. As you see, the only difference between these two command lines are, this has Python 2.7 and this has Python 3.7. So run. Okay, both complete in 1 second. Okay, let us increase the number of URLs and see what happens. Instead of 5, we'll do 10. Similarly here, we'll do 10. Right? Again, both complete in 1 second, which means Python 2.7 is running fast in the Docker container. Okay? So something happened in the Docker container which fixed our problem. We don't know yet, but something happened, right? Stage one, Python 2.7 was running slow, and the Docker container is running fast because we isolated the environment, used a minimal set of modules. But what actually was going on? The good part is that you have your laptop setup now and you have your Docker setup now, which means you can compare both of them. So 2.7 running slow on laptop and running fast on Docker. So if you look at the profiling output, now let us profile the code. So I'm just using the standard libraries of Python to do the profiling, but let us profile Python 2.7 and 3.7 in parallel. Again, we could run profiling through a long winded Docker command also, but I had profile equal to 1, which does the trick for us, easier to read. So, all right. So stage 0, Python 2.7 slow, hence 3 seconds. Stage 1, Python 2.7 fast, hence 1 second. Now, if you look at this output, all right, what is the first thing that you will notice? You'll notice that the code that is running slow has a wait entry. The left side is slow, so it has a wait entry present here. All right. Okay. So there is a wait going on, which is causing slowness. The second part that you will notice is that when you are using requests, gRequests, anything, when you are making an HTTP request, you are actually making sockets. You are doing send and receive and so on. So if we search for receive, you'll see that there are receive calls present both on the left side and on the right side. But both of them are being done by different codes. In this case, it's pyopen ssl.py. In this case, it's SSL, GTE. We don't know what that is, right? So profiling gave us some differences in the two, but not enough to call out what's going on. All right. So let us take this one step ahead. Let us trace our code. So tracing actually, you know, traces all of your function calls and then dumps them together. So we could have trace equal to one and do this. I already have some dumped output. We'll be using this. So stage zero, the slow code, right? And stage one, the fast code. All right. So in this case, in stage zero, if we search for wait, we will see, yes, there are wait statements. A lot of wait statements are there. And in stage one, if we search for wait statements, we won't find any. In stage zero, if we search for receive, you will see, yes, receive is there. And stage one also has receive. But interestingly, the stage one receive uses gevent, which is what we were told. Gevent plus request equal to gRequest. And that's why this is fast. But in this case, the left-hand side, which is slow, the receive call, there is no trace of gevent in this code. And the receive call is being made through this library called OpenSSL SSL.py. Now, if you look it up, if you Google this, you will find that OpenSSL SSL.py belongs to a module called PyOpenSSL. So we might be in a scenario wherein PyOpenSSL is installed on my laptop, but it is not installed in the Docker container because we had a minimal set of modules in the Docker container. So that might be the case. All right. So let us verify that. We can verify that through a simple demo wherein, and Python 3 was running fast on the laptop, right? So Python 2 and Python 3 have a different set of libraries. So if I do Python 2, import OpenSSL, it works, right? In case of Python 3, it doesn't work. It fails. And that is the reason my code was running slow on Python 2.7, but fast on Python 3.7. Okay, so we know that on our laptop. Let us verify this on the Docker container also. So what we'll do is that the Docker container, which was running fast, we'll throw PyOpenSSL at it and see if it starts running slow now. So stage two is stage one plus PyOpenSSL. So the usual modules of stage one plus the highlighted PyOpenSSL module, right? So let us do a demo here and then call that out. You will see that both will start running slow now. So Python 2.7, stage equal to 2, right? So that is the difference there. Python 3.7. Right, both took 3 seconds. So adding PyOpenSSL made them slow. If you compare this with stage one, we don't change anything. We just do stage two equal to stage one. Compare the time difference, 3 seconds, 1 second. Okay, so we know that PyOpenSSL is the culprit. It is causing problems for us. We got this. Why is this happening? The reason this is slow is PyOpenSSL is doing something called monkey patching to the standard library's SSL socket. So now we found out the culprit, but we want to dig a little deeper and find out what is PyOpenSSL doing that is causing us slowness. And monkey patching is a new term that we've encountered in this talk till now. So this is the scenario that you know of. When you add PyOpenSSL, everything becomes slow. All right. So monkey patching is a concept used by gevent behind the hood to make your blocking socket non-blocking, as in to move from send block receive to send send, right? So this is what happens in the background. So it takes a socket library. It does some monkey patching, which is it runs some code. What that code is, what it does, we'll get into that. And it gives you a non-blocking socket. This is easy to know. All right. So let us try this out. Let us actually see what's happening. So if you open a Python interpreter and if we do something like this, let's see what happens. Python 2. We are just importing socket and it is printing socket is socket object, right? So this is a known thing. We are importing a module and we are printing the class of socket, right? But what if we add some code above inspect and see what happens? So if we add these lines and rest of the code is the same, if we add these lines and then we do the same thing, right? We open the interpreter again, right? So you look at the difference here. This was socket.socket and this is gevent.socket, right? In both cases, I'm importing the same module, import socket here, import socket here. But in the second part, I'm prefixing the module import by some code, monkey.patch all. And this is causing a problem. It's causing a good thing, in fact, not a problem. It is converting my blocking socket into a non-blocking socket, right? So monkey patching converts, does a dynamic replacement of attributes at runtime, which makes your code run faster. All right. So this is what gevent does, right? But we don't know what's going on actually in gevent. So if you were to have a simple code like this, and all of this can be tried out, if you have a simple code which just has a function called socket, and it says I will block, and you run that code, which is you import the blocking socket and you print blocking socket dot socket, it will print what you, you know, what you think it prints. It will print I will block. Similarly, if you have a non-blocking socket, and if you import that code and if you run it, it will print I will not block, right? But if you add some lines before importing the blocking socket, it will actually print I will not block. It is actually printing what the non-blocking socket does. But in this case, it's a demo code, so we have access to what patch all does. So if you were to open patch all, the code, it is importing the blocking socket, and this is extremely important to understand. If there is one thing you should go away from this talk, take away from this talk, it is this. So it's you import a blocking socket, you import a non-blocking socket, and you actually overwrite blocking socket dot socket by non-blocking socket dot socket. So you are replacing a blocking socket's attribute at runtime by a non-blocking socket. You are making the code fast. You are saying, hey, from future, if any other code references the blocking socket, give it a non-blocking socket. Great. So let us look at this in a little more detail. We won't get into the details here, but you should check out the notes as well as Kavya Joshi's excellent talk on gevent, which goes into the depth of gevent and explains, you know, explores its entire ecosystem. But how is PyOpenSSL making our code slow? That was the question. So we have grequests, and you have the SSL library of the standard, you know, if you have the standard SSL library. So a monkey comes along and patches this code, which means monkey patching happens. You have a blocking code. It's converted into non-blocking code now, which is great. But then another monkey comes along, and it makes the non-blocking code blocking again. So monkey patching is happening twice, and that is the culprit, right? Let's look at this once again. You patch it, make it non-blocking. You patch it, make it blocking, right? So something's going on. But these are just a diagram of a couple of monkeys. Don't take my word for it. Let us actually see what's going on. This is what we think is happening. You have grequests, which is taking gevent, and it's monkey patching the code. So if you were to open this, and this is real GitHub code, so you know, you can look this up and you'll find all of this code online. So if you were to open grequest.py, you will see a line called curiousgeorge.patchall, and curiousgeorge is just a alias for gevent monkey, right? So you could very well have gevent.monkey.patchall, right? This guy is doing the patching for us. So what, when we say it's doing the patching, what does it mean? So in it calls this function called patchall, and interestingly, patchall has SSL equal to true, and it takes the default value. So it's doing something with SSL. And don't look at the code, but if you just read the documentation of the function, you will see that it says replace class SSL socket with cooperative versions, which means it's saying replace the SSL socket class with a non-blocking version. All right. So gevent is doing the right thing. All right. So, but something else is also happening. Grequest is using request, which is monkey patching again and bringing us to square one. All right. So again, similar flow. The first line that we saw, curious dot dot patch all, we saw the flow of that line that gave us a non-blocking socket, which was great. But then there is a line called request import session. Grequest is obviously using request under the hood. So when you say from request import session, it actually calls this code. And before you even look at the logic of the code, please check out this line. It says, if I get an import exception. Now this is important. If I get an import exception, pass. Don't raise an exception. Don't cause any problems. Just silently ignore the problem. All right. So this means that if you don't have PyOpenSSL installed, nothing will happen. This is the code that is causing us problems. So if you see here, it says PyOpenSSL.inject into URL lib3. And again, if you go up to URL lib3, you don't even look at the code, just read the documentation. It says monkey patch URL lib3 PyOpenSSL with SSL support, which means that if we go a little deeper, you'll see that PyOpenSSL says I'm going to patch SSL context of the standard library. And SSL context of the standard library is giving you an SSL socket, which means both gevent and PyOpenSSL are patching the same thing. And the one who patches the last wins, which means that gevent runs gives you a non-blocking socket, and then PyOpen SSL runs gives you a blocking socket, right? Let us prove this at the code level. So all I'm doing now is that I'm adding socket class equal to 1. I'm making the connection. I'm dumping the socket class for us to see in case of stage 1. Stage 1 is the code that runs fast, right, without PyOpen SSL. And stage 2 is the code that runs slow with PyOpen SSL. So in stage 1, you see the socket class is gevent.ssl socket, which means this is what we wanted. In stage 2, the class is url lib3.contrib.py. So it is giving us a slow socket. It is giving us a blocking socket. So we know that. How do we fix this problem? Don't use PyOpen SSL. But what if you have to use PyOpen SSL? So you look at the functionality of PyOpen SSL and you replace it by a, you know, corresponding module like cryptography. But we don't want that. So we will use gevent open SSL. Gevent open SSL actually a PyOpen SSL version, but it is compatible with gevent. So someone out there faced an issue by using PyOpen SSL and he said that, okay, I'm going to fix this. I'm going to give you a gevent version of PyOpen SSL. Great. So what is the flow in that case? So first you import gevent open SSL in your code, and PyOpen SSL, the red block means that it is a blocking socket. It says that I'm going to monkey patch you, and now you are blessed with gevent capabilities. Great. Then we use our grequests code, which does the usual thing. Gevent comes in, monkey patches our code, and it gives us a non-blocking socket. But then PyOpen SSL trundles along and says, I'm going to make this code blocking. But it doesn't make it block, because although it patches with PyOpen SSL, the first monkey ensured that we get gevent based code. So if you have to understand this in a simpler way, first monkey makes it non-blocking. The second one wants to make it blocking, but someone already prevented that for us. All right, cool. So we have the problem solved for us. So till now, when we are using PyOpen SSL, the code was running slow. Now if we use gevent open SSL, the code should run fast for us. All right, so let's try that out. So we have a stage 3, a Docker container with stage one modules, stage 2, which is PyOpen SSL, which was making us slow. Then we have gevent open SSL, right, which was doing the right thing. So let's see what happens now. So again, we'll run the same code, stage equal to 3, rest all is the same. Stage equal to 3 here for 2.7, stage equal to 3 for 3.7. Right. So 2 ran fast, 3 unfortunately ran slow. We were expecting both codes to run fast because we had taken PyOpen SSL and we had given it the gevent blessing. So 2 became fast, 3 became slow, but stage 1 Python 3.7 was fast. So we took what was fast and we made it slow again, right? So this is crazy. At this point, I was about to quit my job. So stage 1 PyOpen SSL was slow because we knew that PyOpen SSL is going to cause problems for us. We added gevent, and although Python 3 was running fast in all the cases, we made it slow. We actually, reduced our functionality, and considering that we wanted to move to Python 3.7, this was a no-go for us. So how is gevent open SSL making it slow? Now we know something about monkey patching. So we saw earlier that gevent open SSL is coming in and making PyOpen SSL a non-blocking socket. Let us break this down into functions. So first gevent open SSL comes in and patches send, the send function, because these are all socket functions. Then it patches the receive functions, then it patches a bunch of other functions, but unfortunately it does not patch receive into. And receive into is the only call that Python 3.7 uses. Python 2.7 uses receive, and Python 3.7 uses receive into, which is causing problems for us. So partial monkey patching is happening. Earlier we were patching it twice, now we are patching it partially, right? So we are doing the wrong thing. So Python 2.7 actually uses the receive call, if we were to check this out. So if you have to trace the code in Python 2.7, you will see that there is a receive call happening here. And if you have to do the same thing in Python 3.7, there is no receive, there is receive into. So we know that this is what is causing problems. And gevent open SSL is not patching receive into, we know that. But what if we wrote some, a little amount of code to patch it and see what happens, right? So this is stage 4. Same as stage 3, wherein PyOpen SSL, gevent open SSL is there, but we are going to patch some code here, right? So let's look at the observations. Let us verify that at stage 4, there is receive into is not present. So if we were to open the Python prompt of the stage 4 container and we were to stick this code which just takes gevent OpenSSL and dumps all of its attributes, you'll see there is receive but there is no receive into, right? Before patching demo, let us have a demo before patching, stage 4 before patching. Python 3.7 should run slow for us, right? And it does run slow for us. Then you apply the patch. So applying patch is also, you know, I'm doing a Docker exec of a file, but I'm just making it a little more user friendly. So I applied the patch. So if we come back here, you see there was a receive here. There is no receive into. And if I try this out again, verify that the patch is added. We copy paste the same code again. Yay, we have receive into. So we have receive into present, right? And let us look at the demo, after patching demo. Now, if we look at the before patching demo, if you see here, this was the code and this was running slow, 3 seconds, all right? We take the same code and we copy paste the same code. If we run it, it runs fast. So we've achieved what we wanted. I also raised a PR to fix the issue. So this was what we did. So we went from stage 0 to stage 4. And at this point, if I were to tell you there is a stage 5, this would be your reaction. There is no stage 5 and it's over. It's done. And the takeaways from this talk are, please do one migration at a time. Don't mix Python 2.7, 3.7, Docker, HTTPS, Lambda, you'll go crazy. Monkey patching order matters. The one that happens in the end wins. And the answer to the question we called out in the beginning, how many monkeys fit in a Clint Eastwood movie title? The answer is 5.x. And the justification is, you have blocking code and you take one monkey of G event and make it non-blocking. That is the good. Then you have blocking code, G event does the trick, and then PyOpenSSL's monkey comes along and makes it blocking. That's the bad part. And then you try to fix this by using gevent OpenSSL, which means you partially patch it. So gevent does blocking, gevent OpenSSL does non-blocking, and we partially patch it to make it fast for 2.7 and 3.7. That's the ugly part. The good, the bad, and the ugly. Number of monkeys, 5.x, right? So in conclusion, I would like to say that when you are stuck in these kind of issues, if you apply a little bit of patience and you dig deeper, you can actually take the snail of your slow code, strap on the rocket engine of gevent and expect to get away with it. Thank you. So, yeah, do you have any questions? Yeah, hi.
How is this related to the async IO library?
So actually this is not. So we could use Python 3 and you could use async IO, which does all of these things. But we are stuck with Python 2.7 and async IO. I don't think there's good support for that. So we had to use both Python 2.7 and 3.7 because of some legacy dependencies.
You have another year to...
No, I'm not going to do that now. Hopefully I shouldn't run into those issues. But the you know, if we had decoupled the, you know, the URL fetching code from the processing code, we could have made this a little more cleaner. But because both the codes were, you know, present in one library itself, we had to extract out the problematic code and fix it. So that was a problem. That was a bigger problem than the entire issue here though.
Cool. Thank you.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. Hi.
So you have multiple monkey patches to the same function, and then the last one will win, right? Is there a way you can make sure that the first one will
not allow the others to come or something? Yeah, I mean, so monkey patching is just a dynamic replacement of attributes. So you have A equal to B, then B equal to C, C equal to D, and so on, right? So it's that way. You have to dig deeper. So monkey patching is dangerous and you should leave it to the gevent and grequests libraries to handle it under the hood. But in this case, I wanted to, but I had to dig deeper because we were not able to debug the issue easily. Cool. All right. Cool.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Yeah. You can catch me if you want to ask any questions later.